Hello and welcome to this video. In this video, we will examine what TCP is, and we'll look at a practical example of how TCP works, and we will also look at other transport protocols besides TCP. So let's get started. What is TCP? It's an acronym for Transmission Control Protocol, and it's a protocol that operates on the fourth layer of the OSI model. So, if you remember the OSI model where we have the application layer, the presentation layer, the session layer, the transport layer, it's at this transport layer that we have TCP. So what we are going to do now is explain how TCP works and why it's very important for network devices. So the first thing we need to know is that TCP is a connection-oriented protocol. And that means that it actually deals with the integrity of the data that is sent across the network to ensure that it is delivered. And it does this through a process that is called the three-way handshake. What is the three-way handshake? The three-way handshake has to do with performing a three-step process in forming TCP connections. So if you have a client trying to talk to a server, you first have what's called a SYN. Then you have an acknowledgement of that. And then you have a final acknowledgement before the TCP protocol is set up. So the client needs to access a server. The client first sends a SYN packet trying to say hello to the server. And then the server responds with a SYN ACK. And says, hi there, I'm available. And then the client also responds with an acknowledgement. Only then is the three-way handshake complete, and the TCP session is set up. This ensures that whenever I want to have communication, both sides are ready for the communication process before you start transferring data. So that is the first feature of TCP that we are going to look at. The second feature of TCP that we are going to look at is the fact that it has what is called sequence numbers. Sequence numbers are numbers that are sent for every packet that is sent for TCP. So when we send the first packet, we give you the sequence number of 0. And then the next packet has a sequence number of 1 and 2 and 3, all the way to 65,535. So what happens? Why do we need sequence numbers? The reason we need sequence numbers is because when you send the packets, you need to check if the packet gets there. For instance, if you send, for example, packets 1 to 100, and then for some weird reason, the server doesn't get packet 101, the server can ask you to resend packet 101, and once you resend packet 101, it can fit right into where it's supposed to be. And then all the information would be in sequence. So sequence number ensures that the information that is being sent is received in sequence, and you can check for what information was not received. And that is why it's really, really useful for TCP. But if we look at TCP deeply, we would see that it takes a whole lot of time for every packet to be sent and acknowledged. That's why TCP has some other mechanisms to ensure that packets are sent on time and that the integrity of the packet is not compromised. And let's explore some of those mechanisms. The first one that we are going to explore is what is called windowing. In windowing, what happens is that the TCP clients and the server would negotiate what is called a window of packets that will be sent. At the beginning, the window is really small because it just shows the amount of data you can send at a particular time, and it's slowly increased. So you have the window, and then it's slowly increased, and that shows the amount of data that you can send at a particular time. Depending on the size of the window, you can send lots of data and just receive one acknowledgement. So, after setting up the TCP connection and you've done the SYN, the SYN ACK, and the ACK, the clients can start increasing the window size and keep sending data to the server. And how do you know when the window size is full? What happens is that the server would send a message back to the client. But in that message, it would set the window size to 0. And once the window size is set to zero, the client knows that the server's window size is full. And then it would not send messages for a while until there's some more space, and then you can send more messages. With that, we can send far more messages without getting acknowledgement every time, and that helps to increase the speed of the data. So what happens if we send messages and then one particular message is missed? The server would send back a response to the client asking for that particular message, and that's another reason why sequence numbers are really important. So, if it sends back a message and says, I cannot get the message that has sequence number 1, 2, 3, 4, then the client will go back and send a message and say, okay, now this is the information that has sequence number 1, 2, 3, 4. So I just cleared up the screen so that we can have some more space to discuss some more features of TCP. We've talked about the three-way handshake and how it works. We've also talked about windowing. We also mentioned something about being able to selectively ask for other packets, a process that is called selective acknowledgement. Now we're going to look at error detection in TCP. What is error detection? Error detection is a mechanism to be sure that you receive the right packet that you are expecting from the sender. So when the sender sends something to a receiver, the receiver has a way to check if the packet that it received is the right packet, and the way it does this is through a checksum. So a checksum is an algorithm that is run on the packet that is received and that's cross-checked with a particular number. So for instance, if I have a checksum and the checksum is supposed to be 80, and I receive numbers that are 20, 20, 30, and 10, if I run the checksum and the checksum is an additional algorithm, if I add up these numbers together and I get 80, then I know that the messages are correct. But if I don't get 80, then I know that it's wrong. So that's the way it checks and works. So what happens is when you receive the packet, we check the TCP error and then we perform our checks on algorithm. And if we get a correct answer, then we know that the packet was correct. So that's another feature of TCP that makes it a very reliable protocol. Now what we are going to do is that we are going to try to see how TCP works on a live network, and we are going to use a software known as Wireshark to figure this out. Now Wireshark is a packet sniffing software that is used to capture information on a network. So what you could do is you could install Wireshark. It's a free software. Just download it from the internet on your system. And then you'll be able to capture packets of things that are going on in your network and to be able to recap them. So now let's take a look at it. Please go over to howtonetwork.com. Check out all our IT certification courses, practice exams, and live Cisco racks. There's a $1 coupon in the description. The TCP header is usually 20 bytes long. It's often extended with options. The source and destination ports are identifiers. Identifiers are used to locate the application which sends this data or one that's supposed to receive it. The client, the server, usually uses a well-known port, which can be found on the IEANA website. And the client generates a random dynamic port sequence and acknowledgement number. Fields are used to, for data flow control, as discussed previously. Data offset field defines the length of the TCP header in full byte increments. It allows us to determine where the options end and the data starts. TCP packets can have the following flag set, the urgent bit, which is rarely seen and indicates where the sender should start. The acknowledgement bit is used for data flow control. The push bit, which indicates that the data should not be held in the buffer, but directly copied into the memory. The reset bit is to immediately terminate a TCP connection. The synchronized bit is to provide the initial sequence numbers. The finished bit indicates that a process is completed and the connection can be closed. The window field indicates the host receiving buffer in bytes. It's a 2-byte value, which can be increased with window scaling established during the handshake. The checks and field is calculated with the contents of the TCP header data and the IEP pseudo header. The urgent point of field is used with the URG flag. It indicates the point where the receiving host should start reading data.